I'm going to talk about digital. I feel a bit of a heel, really, being asked to talk about digital qualitative when I'm not really sure I've done that much digital qualitative. I've done some, but probably not as much as maybe some of the people in the room. So we'll see how we go. What I would like to say, and to start off by saying, is that we are all digitally tethered. I've just finished a new book that comes out in February with the title Digital Tethering In, and the whole point of the book is based on the idea that the media give us a terrible time about encouraging our young people and our students to use media in interactive ways, but with very little research base. And so the title of this book was based on the fact that my then 13-year-old used to wear her mobile phone in her bra at school so that whenever it vibrated, she could run off to the loos and text her friends or pick up the latest Facebook message that she'd got. She hates me telling me that, but it was because of her. So I believe we are all digitally tethered in some way or another. And that's one of the things I'm really interested in at the moment. But I think when we're starting to look at the stuff around the digital, and I find it troublesome that we refer to it as a singular thing. We talk about the digital, and I'm not sure that that's right. But I do think we do live a lot of our lives online. And I think some of the things that maybe we need to be talking about is, what is it we take for granted? And what is it we see as normal? And lots of the things that maybe the students or young people or us see as normal may not be as normal as maybe we think it is. So I just want to use this opportunity to just raise some questions about some stuff. And so what I'd like to talk about is to start with, is to give you a few examples of research that I've done in the digital realm. And these are the kind of things I wanted to talk a bit about. I wanted to talk first about virtual worlds in higher education, and then problem-based learning simulations and chatbots. And then when I've done that, I will actually give you some new, I hate the word new, or innovative methods or things that are being done in the digital that I guess we've not been using that much of yet.
Learning Innovation is an applied research group based in the Health and Life Sciences Faculty at Coventry University. Led by Professor Maggie Savin-Baden, the team focuses on developing and researching innovative technologies for higher education. Over the past few years, a number of learning projects have been created using the immersive virtual world Second Life. Coventry University's Second Life Island is owned and maintained by several staff members at the university. It includes a number of interesting and interactive features such as a stone meeting circle, flying tour cushions, and an orientation area for newcomers to Second Life. One of the team's oldest and most successful projects, Preview, is still available on the island. The Preview project focuses on using problem-based learning in a virtual world to teach healthcare management to students. It makes use of Second Life's interactive features such as roleplay, artificially intelligent chatbots, and collaborative whiteboards. A new engineering and computing building in the university is currently being built in real life. To give staff members and students a better idea of what their new offices will look like, a simulated version was built for them to explore. The virtual engineering and computing building will also soon house learning scenarios for students on a project management module. A training bot has been developed for a medical deanery in the northwest of England. This bot is designed to assist international first-year students in adjusting to a new culture and understanding protocols. In addition, several learning scenarios have been developed on the subjects of surgery, ethics and diversity, and patient care. The virtual city is currently being built for a new course at Coventry University. One of the modules on the Children and Young Persons Palliative and Complex Care course is based completely online, using Second Life and the virtual learning environment Moodle. Two child patient case studies are located in the virtual city, and the students are required to undertake weekly tasks and gather information by visiting key locations and important people involved in the patient's care. A collaborative project between Coventry University and the University of Texas Arlington focuses on doing a comparative study on the use of clinical simulations. A replica of a pediatric scenario using high-fidelity mannequins at the University of Texas Arlington has been developed in Second Life. Research into the students' responses to both scenarios is currently undergoing. Several Second Life videos have been developed to be housed in Coventry University's open source repository for staff members to use. Designed to act as accompanying materials for problem-based learning scenarios, the videos focus on the subjects of child nursing, customer services, and adult nursing. These are just a few examples of learning scenarios that have been developed by the team.
But the two examples I particularly want to talk about are the socio-political impact of learning in virtual worlds and the use of chatbots to examine cyber influence. So the first one was funded by the Levy Hume Trust and had three PhD students attached to it who looked at pedagogy, student experience and identity. And they did their studies, and what they did was, because when we got this money in 2008, we thought, oh, there's going to be more worlds than Second Life going to be going on. And there were a few, but largely they disappeared. So most of the studies ended up looking at Second Life. I'm assuming everybody's familiar with Second Life here, are they? It's a virtual world where you go in and you create. Have you seen the film Avatar? Yes? Well, it's a bit like the film Avatar, except you go in and you create your own avatar and then you teach and learn in that space. But what we did at the end of the project was we developed a methodology which we called participatory action synthesis, where what we did as a group of three PhD students and two researchers, we worked as a team and we reanalyzed the data, reinterpreted the data together in order to see what might come out of it. So the first study by Matt Moore was on the tutors' experience of virtual worlds in higher education and the design and development of virtual world pedagogy using case study methodology. One of the other students looked at the students' perspectives on using it as learning technologies using constructivist graded theory. And then the last student, looked at students' understandings and expressions of management identity in virtual worlds through narrative inquiry. So as you can see already, it was quite troublesome to try and look at a grounded theory with a case study with a narrative inquiry. And we had lots of arguments about whether we could use anything with grounded theory at all whatsoever. But it was the slightly more flexible use of grounded theory. So what we did was we developed this methodology together which we called participatory action synthesis, where we took the primary research data from the different but associated studies and worked as a team. And we had to look at our own stances and our own views, the participants, the context, the different researchers involved. And so to begin with, it was quite a tough process and involved quite a lot of arguments about what was okay and what wasn't. But it was also a good process because it made us work very well as a team to analyse and reanalyse and interpret and work together to actually take account of individual stances. But some of the issues that I just wanted to raise when doing that kind of thing, because it was a kind of new methodology in the context of a digital study, which is why I wanted to share it with you, is the whole issue around plausibility. How do you ensure this kind of rigour when you're synthesising, when you're dealing with different truths and different realities and different interpretations? And how do you manage those truths across five of you? Also, how do you deal with the stuff that isn't said? How do you ensure that some shared views were not privileged? We had one researcher in the team who was very eloquent and very voiceful, and we just had to be careful that view didn't overlay too much some of the others. And also we had to look at what were the expressed realities we saw that were just accepted with any kind of scrutiny, and how did we manage some of that stuff? And what kind of contradictions were revealed which maybe had not come out in the original studies? So they were some of the things that we looked at. What we did was, and we published a paper on this, if you're interested, which came out last year, but what we found through doing this study was that actually there need to be a much stronger implementation of liquid curricula. Something that Mel and I were talking about over lunch, about the focus on the students and the tutors together rather than separating them, working with mutual stances and shared identities and looking at sharing and working together. And so the kind of things that we were arguing for was the designing of courses and modules that enhance not just flexibility but also uncertainty, charting the discourses that shape students' experiences, and taking account of students' perspectives in order to support their needs better when learning in virtual worlds. So that's one study. The other one is chatbots. How many people here have heard about chatbots? Know about chatbots? Okay, you've obviously booked an airline ticket recently or been to IKEA. Chatbots are virtual characters on websites. Most of the time they're deeply irritating because you put a question in and they don't answer it, or they say, I don't understand this, or that's not part of my brief, or whatever. We're working with a company who does lovely pretend things, like they set up a chatbot and they put a real person behind it and they don't tell anybody they're doing that. So there's kind of some Turing-y things going on. So we were asked to work with this company to evaluate stuff, and we've done a degree of research with them, and based on things like the realism of chatbots, whether they're anthropomorphic, whether they're realistic, what people think about synthesized voices, and that's some of the past research. A lot of this research has been funded by the Ministry of Defence, which has brought its own interesting problems, particularly when it got spread across the Guardian one Monday morning and I was rung by the press office to say what's going on. But what we did was we wanted to see whether students told more to the chatbot than they actually did using an online questionnaire, and got some quite interesting results. In the main, most students felt that they'd not told the chatbot any more than they'd done on the online questionnaire, but actually when we looked at the data, they had, particularly the men. The men talked a lot to the chatbots. The women were less trusting. But what came out of all of this is that issues of truthfulness and disclosure was something that students often don't think about that much, as many of us know, on websites. And we actually asked them to talk about lifestyle choices around drinking and sexual health and cheating and all sorts of things. And for us, it wasn't really a new methodology per se, but it was a new research area in the digital. And so these are the kind of questions that we began to ask. How do these chatbots, these pedagogical agents, affect students' perceptions? Do they say more to different types of pedagogical agent? Do they prefer them to an online questionnaire? How much will they disclose? And does the pedagogical agent influence the person's reaction? We also found that what most of the students chose, because they could choose who they talked to, what they looked like and what they sounded like, most of them chose to speak to a professionally dressed woman in about her 30s. Across the piece, they all did that. We don't know why, we're following that up. So the things that became important were the appearance of the pedagogical agent, what the choice that the student had, and how much they disclosed. Again, if you're interested, there's stuff on my website, there's papers up there. If you're madly interested in this kind of stuff, there are stuff that you can just get preprints of. But I think what I'd really like to talk about now is they were some of the things I've done in the digital realm, but these are some of the things that I think we need to be thinking about in the future. Ethnography for the internet, Christine Hines' work's been around for a while. Immersive ethnography is something that we developed through the studies on virtual worlds and the growing area of digital arts-based research. Again, how many of you are familiar with Christine's work? Yeah, a few people. She gave a talk at Coventry just before Christmas, and her perspective slightly shifted from this one. Now, but I still think the work that she's doing is very interesting, although I'm not sure I would call it ethnography. I would take some issues around whether that is really ethnography or not, getting a nod from the front here. But it's about living, working, researching, working in and through the virtual spaces of the internet. So that's kind of what she's arguing for. I think we'd be better, immersive ethnography, I think you could call it ethnography if you're living and working in immersive worlds. And that's certainly what the PhD students on that project I spoke about did. They lived and worked online in immersive worlds for 2 years, which was tough and tiring. They collected data through residing in virtual worlds, from observing and participating, through problemizing cultural norms, and seeing everything that they lived and breathed in their virtual worlds as data. So this was an approach that we called immersive ethnography because it's about being immersed in a virtual world, but it was not just about collecting data through interviews or watching what they do. It really was quite autobiographical as well, sorry. This is actually another book I've just finished with a colleague, Catherine Wimpany, called Arts Related Research, which came out just before Christmas. And what I really want to talk about is just some of the things that we explored in part in this arts related book that relate to the digital. This is my skiing holiday. The first bit is not my work. It's from Maggie Stogner from Washington. And she's a kind of journalist and artist and works in museums. So she does research around storytelling within the museum sector. That's readable, I hope, at the back. So some of this will cross over into things like digital storytelling, if you've used that before. But she used participatory narratives where people create and critique and curate, because she's a curator as well. Everyday heroes. So, she gets them to create their own quests and journeys, and then she puts them on film and then shares them. So again, they're accessible and open. And so she's got the one from Memory to Action at the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington. Then collective narratives where the authorial voice is formed through with others and aggregated into mega stories, and Question Bridge is one of those, again, accessible. And then this is kind of personally my favorite one, Gradually Melt the Sky, where people use mobile narratives, whatever sources they're using on the move, apps, superimposed videos, poems, those kinds of things. And it creates something that's kind of beyond the mundane. It makes the normal, what was that phrase about making what we're very familiar makes the familiar strange. And I think that really does this very well in a digital realm. The other one is digital installation art. There are lots of ways of looking at digital installation arts, projects, interactive videos, virtual worlds. We had a project at Coventry that was set up by a guy called Ian Upton. And he set up a huge screen in the Herbert Art Gallery, and he got some colleagues from around mainly the US, Canada, to come dressed up into the virtual world Second Life, projected it into the gallery, and so it was an installation that people could interact with. And what we found that was really amazing was we thought all the teenagers would come and chat with these avatars, but they didn't, they hated it, they just walked away. And it was the grandmas, the granddads bringing the young kids in half term who really got this and really engaged with it. So again, just another way of looking at data, looking at interaction, collecting data through digital installation art. Lots of different forms, that's just one example. Vidding, again, people familiar with vidding? You've got young people doing vidding, where you, content's refashioned or created to present a different perspective, usually done with music videos and television programmes, but it seems to be a growing art research form because it's great at interrupting, again, what is seen as normal and acceptable. And then digital message art, which again is a phrase I've developed in conjunction with talking with Carl Lego from the University of British Columbia. It's based on the idea of, is it sandwiches? Do you want me to stop?
Yes.
Shall I stop for sandwiches?
Not necessarily mid-sentence.
I'll finish.
I think you finish.
Yeah, I've only got about four more slides, I think. Yeah, okay. Finish and then we'll pause for sandwiches. Okay, so digital message is based on the idea of literary message art, which is the process of creating stories that are braided and rooted in history as well as stories of becoming. And so I was quite interested in developing literary message into digital message. And so what we've worked on is the idea of how do we blur genres and texts and histories and stories in digital formats, a bit like this work of Maggie Stogner's in Washington, that recognises the value in the spaces between and across cultures and generations and representational forms. And how do we manage these? How do we braid them? And when they're braided, what do they look like? So it's about co-production, co-creation with participants to braid their stories together. And I asked Carl in this book, in the book called Arts Related Research, we asked different people from around the world to bring their stories to the book about their own experience of arts related research. And Carl said, could he write a poem? So I said, of course. So he wrote a poem which I'll share with you in a minute. And he said, as a poet and fiction writer, I'm always seeking ways to compose stories and essays in creative performances. And for him, digital message is a way of creative braiding. So this was his poem that he gave us, wrote for us for the book. Do I need to know where I've come from? Where I'm going? The whirling dervish of derivation and delineation. Perhaps I should make up stories and learn to live well in the places of métissage, where stories know what I can't know, even as I braid the possibilities and the possibilities braid me. So I'm just going to finish with a few questions. Does digital research really exist? I don't know. Is it just something we do in the digital? Is it just research methods we already used in different spaces? I'm not sure. Has Web 2, Web 3 brought new sites and practices, new theoretical frameworks? Or are we just reusing, vidding, old ones? Are there too many choices? I think there probably are. Are we lured by the readily available? Is it just easy to go in there and capture a bit of data and then run off and transcribe it and present it? I don't know, but I think we may be. But the question for me really in all of this, does this kind of digital qualitative research, does it help us to be more participatory? I guess I hope so.